So may I please welcome the panelists for our next session, policymaker Amarjeet Singh and pension industry veteran Eloy, who will be discussing how we can future ready our portfolios for a new regulatory framework. Over to you, Ajit.
Hi, good evening, good afternoon, good morning to those who've just joined in. We just had a very powerful discussion with Mohandas Pai. And now we're going to have a dual power discussion with two really phenomenal individuals who will talk about how India can be future ready and in terms of accepting capital from international markets and getting everything ready for this new future where things like the UN SDG 17, climate change, all of those are now being regulated and legislated, which was never the case in the previous few sort of decades. I'm delighted to welcome Mr. Amarjeet Singh, the executive director of SEBI. Amarjeet has been with SEBI for over two decades, has been on various committees, including the creation of what's happening now, the Social Stock Exchange, and was involved with the ministry in the creation of the CSR. Thank you, Amarjeet, for being with us. Our next guest is Mr. Eloy Lindaji. Eloy was, till November last year, the chief investment management, the head investment honcho, if you will, of the largest pension in Europe, PGGM. Eloy has had an illustrious career. Prior to that, he was with the Dutch bank. And in the last few years, he's been involved with Bloomberg on the sort of climate reporting committee to ensure that banks across the world will start ensuring that they report on the impact of their loans on climate change. Eloy is also on the board of GIIN, the Global Institutional Investor Network, which is also supporting ESG frameworks around the world. So with this, gentlemen, can I jump in with my first sort of question, if that's okay with you all? Yep. So if we look at what's happening in the world, right now, at this point in time, we've got the UN SDG 17 goals to be met by 2030. We've got the Paris Climate Accord, which has created targets of 2035 to 2050. So what were the impact of the 1991, the July 1991 economic reforms on corporate India? First to you, Amarjeet, some sort of history and some sort of color on the role of SEBI as a regulatory and development body, and what is SEBI doing and has done to be future ready to allow capital from institutions like PGGM, like CalPERS, like CalSTRS, from the international community and from internal source of capital. What is SEBI doing to ensure that capital that's entering the financial markets will start being used and be implemented in a way that meets those criteria of the SDG 17 and the climate change accords? Amarjeet, you're on mute. Sorry.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Ajit. I hope I'm audible.
Yes.
Totally. Yes. So it's always a pleasure to be in discussion with you, Ajit. You ask an interesting question. And as you mentioned, I've been with SEBI for last more than two decades. And, I've seen the journey of SEBI since almost the time when SEBI Act was passed and SEBI was set up as a statutory body. So the mandate given to SEBI by Parliament was that we are supposed to develop the market, regulate the market, and also protect the interest of investors. So that mandate, is still there. It is evergreen. I mean, these are basic objectives which a securities market regulator is, supposed to deal with. But it's been a very interesting journey, if I can say, over the last 25 years or so since the SEBI Act was passed, actually almost three decades now. So we've come a long way since then. So any way you look at it, in terms of the number of products that were available at the time, you know, this SEBI was set up, or the number of players that were there, the participation of various kinds of investors, the depth in the market, the practices, the technology, everything has undergone a sea change over time. You know, coming from SEBI, I can always say that SEBI has done a great job, but probably that's not the right way to look at it. You need to be very objective in terms of assessing whether SEBI has delivered on its mandate or not. So I would like to pick up some data points, perhaps, you know, in terms of what have been the outcomes since SEBI was created. So just one data point on the market cap to GDP ratio. So this used to be only about, you know, 25 to 50% during 1990s. It has climbed to more than 80% during the last 5 years. Of course, 2021, it was around 104%. So the market has, and you know, the market cap to GDP ratio is a criteria which is used to see the development of the market. So I think on that front, we've come a long way. Whatever other data points, you look at market turnover, you look at individuals' average share in trading, this has remarkably gone up, especially in the last few years. Now the turnover of individuals in our market is around 45%, which used to be much less earlier. In fact, only 2 years back, it was only 39%. Outstanding corporate bond, you know, today they account for 1/3 of the outstanding bank credit to commercial sector. So we seem to be moving away from the bank-led economy to market-based economy. Enforcement has improved. There are today proactive regulatory interventions to reduce the potential harms that can be caused to investors. We've not had any market-wide scam, if I can say that, since last two decades. So the faith and trust of investors, both domestic and foreign investors, has increased many fold over time. So if you look at the FPI data, foreign portfolio investors data, over the last 20, 25 years, I believe there are only 4 or 5 years when they were negative, you know, in terms of their inflows to the country. Otherwise, most or every year on year, they have been, you know, positive inflows. And in fact, we had a record $37 billion in 2021. If you look at the AUM of mutual funds, that has also increased from Indian rupees. It used to be about 12 trillion rupees in 2016, which is now around 31 trillion at the end of financial year 21. So I think all these data points give you some sort of confidence that the markets have come of age. You know, the regulator has come of age. A lot is happening in this space. And also, if you look at the IMF World Bank assessments on the ISCO principles, etc., again, you know, we have done well on most of the ISCO principles of securities regulation. We are either fully compliant or broadly compliant. So I have represented SEBI in ISCO for a long time. So, you know, and it feels nice to be in the meeting room and seeing that, you know, our practices are as good as any developed market would have. So that was the rear view. In terms of your next question was in terms of future ready. So I think, you know, we have a moving target as a regulator, and we have to be. So I think there are three things which are important. One is we have to understand that the society's expectations from regulators world over, they've really increased in the last decade or so. There's a lot of expectation from regulators. And of course, you know, we don't have any magic wand, so we can't really kind of stop all crises in the market, or, I mean, we don't have those kind of, how should I say, I mean, I don't think that is even expected of us. See, the accidents can happen. The things can go wrong sometime. But as long as we are vigilant, we are nimble-footed, We are skillful, and we keep, you know, updating our toolbox in tune with the demands of the time. And we should be seen to be, you know, doing all of this. If that is the case, then I think probably we would have, one would expect that one has reasonably delivered on one's mandate. But talking more specifically, I think, you know, SEBI has, you know, SEBI has been assessing the needs of the environment on a regular basis and making changes from time to time. So let me just give you one or two examples in the interest of time. So there was this requirement of promoters lock-in when you raise money through IPOs. A certain 20% promoters contribution has to be locked in, and the excess of that has to be locked in for 1 year and 20% for 3 years. We recently liberalized that regime. And this was, I think, a path-breaking move because this has been there for a long time. Now we want to move away from the concept of promoter to controlling shareholders. Again, another sort of path-breaking agenda that we are dealing with. New products and platforms like AIFs, social venture funds, REITs, InvITs, social stock exchange. In fact, today we had a board meeting. And you mentioned about social stock exchange. Today, our board, I'm happy to inform, has approved the creation of a social stock exchange. Oh. And you know, now we have to write the regulations for making it happen. And I must just briefly mention technology before I stop. We are also very mindful. Okay, let me, as far as technology is concerned, you know, the securities markets are not new to technology. See, we've always had, way back, we started screen-based trading, you had a DMAT environment. So I believe this sector has been ahead of many other sectors when it comes to adoption of technology. And now things are changing even further. So so some of the recent initiatives where, you know, we've made use of technology is like UPI we've adopted, and which is, you know, which I think is delivering very well because very large size offerings are happening and UPI is helping us make the process more efficient. We've also, you know, within SEBI, we are looking at how we can leverage data analytics to improve our surveillance capabilities. We are also, you know, we've also introduced regulatory sandbox, innovation sandbox to encourage innovation in the market. So Ajit, I'm not sure how much time I have, so maybe I'll pause. I can go on, you know. But
absolutely. I mean, you know, SEBI has done a lot, and you know, you're part of SEBI, and you've seen the evolution, as you mentioned, over the last two decades plus. So you built the platforms to ensure that investors in India, whether international or retail, are safe and are comfortable. That's what SEBI's done as a regulatory body over the last few decades. Eloy, turning over to you. As an allocator at PGGM, and you have a lot of friends still in the industry, although you're no longer actively involved with it, what is it that PGGM was looking at two decades ago? How has that changed as you all are allocating capital in this more complex world of, you know, the regulations, so some of which you have helped create, as I mentioned about the banking side on the climate disclosure? You know, how are the allocators going to view investing around the world across asset allocation, across asset classes?
Yeah, thank you, Ajit. And if you look at long-term investors like PGGM, they've taken an increasingly serious look from the 90s in increasing the allocation towards emerging capital markets, under the recognition that clearly future growth and future returns in a worldwide diversified portfolio will be increasingly coming from those emerging nations and emerging capital markets. And so while initially I think the focus was on the plumbing, looking at what is a custody arrangement, what are the regulations of the government regarding dividend taxes or withholding taxes, and are there tax treaties in place that especially these long-term investors, the pension funds, they don't end up paying double taxes. So the focus was very much, I think, initially on this type of plumbing and taxation and actually getting to know the ways to enter the market. And I think the central bank has been usually beneficial, for instance, in the case also of India, in maintaining a lot of contacts with the central banks, in which in those years, in the 90s, the oversight of custody activities of pension funds, for instance, in the Netherlands, was still with the Netherlands central bank. So the fact that there were a lot of central bank to central bank contacts between the Netherlands and the Indian Reserve Bank, I think, made a lot of difference also in terms of helping Dutch investors to navigate this new investment opportunity. Now, of course, we are, with all the reforms and the enormous growth in the Indian economy, many of the investors, I think, benefited enormously from the growth of capital markets in India and started tiptoeing also into private markets. So in private markets, we're looking at private real estate, private equity, infrastructure, sometimes private credit in India also. And there, increasingly, the search has been for reliable local partners that you can build a long-term aligned relationships with, to the extent that you do not have offices on the ground. So many investors don't. So some have had the foresight to open an office in India and to build local networks, but others are constrained for whatever reason that they cannot do this. They're even more dependent on having this local partner, local aligned partners in private markets. So that has been another expansion and allocation increasingly of the long-term investors. Now, for instance, in the Netherlands, is about 25% to private markets. Now, if you look at India, private markets are still relatively underweighted relative to other areas. And I think it has, I think there, the search, many of the Dutch investors don't have local offices in India. So the search for local partners have probably been a little bit more difficult than if you can actually trade shares and bonds from behind your desk in the Netherlands in an open Indian capital market. So that really explains why, in the case of the Netherlands, and it's probably also true for a lot of European insurance companies, the focus has still been on public markets. Now, the big change, I think, going forward is that while traditionally, you know, we started out with a focus on plumbing, taxation, risk and return and diversification, and basically adhering the philosophy of efficient capital markets and doing the portfolio construction in an almost mechanical way, right, towards more value-based investing. So I think it started obviously with questions regarding ethical questions, including the impact of companies on the environment, labor practices, human rights, and these have started to factor in increasingly importantly into the screening practices in public markets. That was initially from the what do we don't want to own given our certain value set.
And now, a negative list. It was a negative screening developed
ever since, I think, the whole apartheid issue in South Africa, and then it went to all kinds of other topics. So negative screening became much more developed. But then we started introducing the sustainable development goals, and very much became a common language between business and investors and governments in terms of prioritizing those values that are important to society, which go far beyond financial value. And then long-term investors in the Netherlands, but also in other countries, adopting sustainable development goals as guiding posts towards trying to understand which companies in their portfolio take a wider stakeholder approach and actually contribute to the realization of these SDGs. So now we're seeing new techniques being put in place. I'm not even talking about regulation yet, but just, let's say, technology, you know, the digitalization, artificial intelligence, but it's usually beneficial for instance, being able to scrape all the public information out there, even on private companies, and to start monitoring which products and services these companies, public and private, can somehow be mapped to the 165 underlying indicators of the 17 development goals, the UN development goals. And so that mapping is now being done. And for instance, I was involved last year in launching a company called the Sustainable Development Investment Asset Owner Platform. And that platform uses these AI techniques to do this type of mapping, but cannot yet measure impact. So it does gives you kind of a likelihood. So this company has products X, Y, and Z, and we give it a likelihood from factor 1 to 5 that it actually contributes. We don't know for sure. And we can't measure really impact yet. But it's a big step forward, because the next step is actually to build partnerships to measure impact. Mm-hmm. And I think there's where you're seeing new, very promising developments. I you know, one of the things that makes me so enthusiastic about the Global Impact Investing Network is their Impact Lab, and where investors are coming together and trying to find metrics and benchmarks to actually measure non-financial impacts. So this could be anything from social issues to the environment, to agriculture, to microfinance, right. And you start finding common metrics. And I think that's hugely important as investors move from risk return only to risk return impact as guiding principles to structure their investments. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot to be said about the regulatory environment, which is having a lot of influence in this field. So TCFD being rolled up potentially in a sustainable standards board at IFRS, but we can probably come to that later. Yeah. But I think it's very encouraging that investors voluntarily are already moving in an important direction, and that will influence their choices in how they invest in India going forward.
Right. So let me sort of put some macro numbers on this discussion, right? We now have an economy a little below $3 trillion in terms of GDP in India, probably rising to $15 to $18 trillion over the next couple of decades as we graduate from a low-income economy to a middle-income economy. That's the pathway going forward. And in terms of source of capital, we have a relatively high savings rate in India, but there's no way that there's enough savings in India to power that growth. So we will continuously need a lot of foreign capital, whether it's in bonds or equity or the private markets, wherever. But we'll be needing foreign capital. When we did this mapping, and I wear the hat now of this Quantum Advisors, when we did this mapping a few years ago, we felt that India could actually receive $100 billion plus of equity flows every single year into the Indian stock market. Right now we're about 20 billion, and that's a great year. So we could be 5x, 6x, 7x going forward. But now they're looking for high growth economies to make profits. You have allocators like PGGM, like CalPERS, CalSTRS, the Canadian pensions, the Japanese pensions, everyone. You got everyone now starting to measure, you know, even if they can't measure the impact, they want to at least start calibrating what's happening in the companies, in the markets that they operate in. What's happening on gender diversity, what's happening on the pay gap between the CEO and the median income of a company, what's happening on carbon emission, GHG, greenhouse gas emissions. So all that is happening. Now, SEBI, looking forward, what will SEBI start doing to ensure that foreign investors haven't gotten over the plumbing, which Eloy spoke about, the custody and the comfort level of dealing with India, the T+2 cycle, the T+1 cycle, all that is clear. Now, what will SEBI do to accept and entertain this new form of capital, which has become much more sensitive to all these things we just spoke about? That's to you, Amarjeet.
Yeah, so Ajit, I guess maybe I can talk a little bit about the Social Stock Exchange initiative in the context of what you just mentioned. So as you rightly said, I think if we want to achieve SDGs, if we want to move towards that, we really need loads of capital. In fact, if I remember correctly, Niti Aayog, in its assessment that was done in 2020, there was a review, voluntary national review, where they mentioned that India needs to increase its SDG spending by an additional 6.2% of its GDP until 2030. So you are right, we'll have to significantly scale up our financing. And also another relevant data point here is that India's ranking in the Human Development Index is 131. amongst 189 countries. So clearly we have a long way to go. And the moot question is the government spending enough? Conventional financial capital, is that enough to meet our goals? Probably not. So, you know, we need to tap into capital from all sources. It could be private capital, philanthropic capital, or, you know, the blended finance, innovative structures. So I think towards this, what SEBI is doing, in fact, that's the decision that we took today, this bringing in the social stock exchange concept, it's a relatively uncharted territory, I would say. And especially for us, it was, you know, starting on a zero base. And I'll just like to give you very brief contours of the framework. So what we've said is that, you know, this will be social stock exchange will be a separate platform on one of the existing stock exchanges. It is not a new exchange as such. It will only be a new platform. And what it will do is it will onboard nonprofit organizations which are actually engaged into social activities. And we've given a list of 15 activities which will be eligible for listing, you know, on the exchange. And these 15 activities actually go back to, they are having linkages with UN SDGs and our national priorities. So that is part one. Once you have, you know, once you are engaged into that, and then, you know, you can list subject to certain eligibility norms in terms of some numbers, how much you should have spent in 1 year and what is the capital receipt for 1 year, etc. 50 lakhs and 10 lakhs, I think that's what it is. Then, you know, once you are there, you will be able to raise money from a number of sources, number of instruments. So one new instrument is a zero coupon, zero principal bond, where the idea is that the investor who's subscribing to that bond, he has no expectation of any financial return. All that he's expecting is the social impact, that money, which is, it's like a donation, which is giving, what is the impact that money creates? So this entity, which is on the exchange, will have to disclose every year what impact it is creating. And we've given a social impact monitor. We've given the metrics of disclosure around social impact. And it doesn't stop with that. Also, once you've disclosed, you are not taken on the face value. We've also brought in the element of assurance on those disclosures. So we put in place a social audit framework. We have the, you know, the group recommended all the details as to how the social audit framework will operate. So we don't want, we want in on this platform that there should be trust from day one. So, you know, we don't want any fly-by-night kind of entities to come and not be, you know, responsible enough in terms of their raising from the market. So I talk only about one instrument. Then we have some existing structures, like we have mutual funds. And I know, you know, Quantum has been engaged in that through Help Your NGO. And we also have where the investor chooses to donate its return on the fund to a social cause. We've also, you know, made a lot of changes today on the social venture fund side, just to, you know, make it more attuned to the social stock. We've reduced the threshold substantially. So today, now what we've approved today is that in a social venture fund, which will 100% invest into a zero coupon, zero principal bond kind of instrument, even 2 lakhs will be acceptable. 200,000 rupees can be invested, whereas this limit was 10 million. So, you know, so number of such things we've done. And then, you know, the report also talks about the blended finance structure, like development impact bond, where you have outcome funder, risk investor, intermediary, implementation agency, auditor, and so on. It's a beautiful structure, and it has delivered in many geographies, and we would like to see more of it in India. In fact, in India also, there are a couple of successful examples. Just the last piece. Just the last piece of the framework is that we are also mindful that the non-profit entities who will come to this platform may not be so well organized as the private commercial enterprises are, because obviously they are not so rich on resources and so on. So the board has approved the creation of a capacity building fund for handholding of such non-profit entities, and that is a 100 crore fund, which will not only create awareness about the program, about the exchange, but also handhold in terms of training them on the disclosure practices, audit requirements. Basically, it's a huge cultural shift which will happen.
Yeah.
So I'm quite excited about it, but let's see where we land on that. I'll pause with that.
So the social stock exchange is for new enterprises to some extent on the social sector, but there's $3.5 trillion of market cap on the existing stock exchange, listed companies on the existing stock exchanges. What is SEBI's rule? And I know you'll come out to the business responsibility report. Maybe you can talk a bit about that, about how this existing 3.5 trillion has to start reporting metrics that would make groups like PGGM, the Canadian Pensions, the CalPERS, CalSTRS, the Japanese more comfortable that the capital is being used in the right way and that the companies they invest in are not doing bad things with the capital that they invest.
Thanks for mentioning about BRSR. So we have come out with a framework called Business Responsibility and Sustainability Reporting. And this new framework will be effective on a mandatory basis from next year. Just to give a context, previously we had a business responsibility report, which was applicable to top 1,000 companies. But that was more of a qualitative report. It didn't have many data points. But in this BRSR, I think this is a quantum leap, into the area of sustainability disclosures. So we had a very intensive process of consultation with various standard setters, including GRI, SASB, and others, and also here with industry also, we had a number of roundtables. And the framework, I would just like to make one mention, world over, there's a lot of emphasis on climate-related disclosures. And this framework also has, climate-related disclosures. But at the same time, we've consciously followed a climate plus approach. So, we don't want to be only climate disclosure, only focusing on climate-related disclosures. Our approach is it should be a climate plus approach, considering our ground realities. The huge social and economic disparities that we have in our country, I think it's very important to capture disclosures on those issues, on the social side, on the governance side, and so on. So I believe the framework has about 500 data points. So it will help the investors in a big way in terms of, improving their understanding of the sustainability related issues in corporates, and also help the corporates in identifying the risks that they face going forward, and also identify the opportunities. So, and I'm very happy, that there is a lot of interest in the corporate sector on BRSR. And we are talking to various groups, and there's a lot of excitement around this. And some of the corporates have already started implementing before it kicks in mandatorily in next year. So all in all, it seems to be heading in the right direction.
That's fantastic. Eloy, to you. Now
I'm very impressed by this initiative. I think it's so important.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it is absolutely. Absolutely. So you've got, PPGGM, the Dutch pensions, the European pensions, the Canadian pensions, the US pensions, everyone. There's a lot of capital out there looking for returns, right? Because that returns is what pays off the pensioners who've retired in all these sort of external countries that India needs capital from. At the same time, they're more sensitive, and it's a requirement to have better policing of how the capital is used for ESG, SDG 17 climate. So yep. What you've just heard from Amarjeet, that's obviously making you smile. You said you're excited already. So how will you bridge that gap? What do you think the allocation models will look like? How important will things like the BRSR be? Or are the external allocators likely to build their own models, their own metrics, and look at Indian companies from their lens rather than what SEBI is mandating?
I think it's hugely important. If I look, for instance, at the performance last year of the concentrated, responsible, long-term investment portfolio, which much less names than the worldwide index, the MSCI, it outperformed the MSCI index by about 8 full percentage point, which was an all-time record. And so actually long-term investors are waking up to the fact that these things that have been pilot portfolios within there. So in the case of some investors, this is usually not more than a few percentage point of their total allocation, but they've been working on these portfolios for, in some cases for over 10 years and building experience in portfolio construction and selecting names across different impact categories. For instance, at PGM, we had one which was focused on initially four themes, health, food, climate and food and water security, and now that's being mapped into a number of other additional sustainable development goals such as sustainable cities, responsible consumption and production. So you're seeing the expansion. So that while that could initially be mapped to five, now it's about seven other long-term investors, such as APG, which also in the Netherlands covers the education sector, would also have issues in regarding companies that are involved in supporting the educational system would be part of their impact universe. So but if there's data to support measuring what they're actually realizing, then that will be hugely beneficial in allowing them to actually to tweak their portfolios in a way that I'm convinced that we will invest in the future in less names. Because as this information comes through, the companies that just perform less on these impact metrics will fall out of the investable universe. Because you want to show to your beneficiaries that you are not only generating a return which is enough for pensions. And let's face it, a lot of these European investors are not looking for double-digit returns necessarily, because in many cases, their coverage ratios can be maintained if they get about 4% return in euros. They want a safe, solid return with good financial, with good impact on ESG factors. So as long as you can demonstrate that you are doing good in these other areas, people will be willing to actually have a portfolio. Didn't necessarily have the highest return of all possible portfolios, but they have a strong investment belief that this portfolio, notwithstanding short-term returns, will do much better on the long term. So I think that when the data is there, you're going to see more concentrated portfolios and overweighting those companies or basically excluding companies that don't report or can be viewed as having bad business practices. So and I think it'd be usually beneficial for it as India leads the way on this reporting framework that if you want to track 100 billion a year in this type of capital, I think it's very promising.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, again, as someone who's watched the markets over the last few years, over the last few decades, you know, the rate of return of the BSE index since the year 2000 in dollar terms has been about 12% per annum compounded, right, of the index. That's not even trying to figure out the smart manager and everything else that can add alpha, as you say, to that. And the rate of return required by the pensions in the Western world, as you correctly pointed out, tend to be between 4 to 6.5, 7% in US dollar terms. So you've got that fantastic match, and they hopefully have to bridge it. But you know, if you think about the way allocation has been done by the pensions, by the sovereign so far, it's been, you've got the 100 euro, and then you invest something in bonds, you put something in public markets, something in private markets, something in you know, which you may go into infrastructure, hedge funds, etc., real estate, right, and fixed assets. So that's kind of the thing. But should there be, and this is something that I've been sort of trying to get people to focus on, should there be something like a Save My World allocation, where every pensioner effectively is telling PGGM, telling the Canadian pensions, telling everyone that, look, if you've got $100 or 100 euro of mine to manage, why can't you take 1 euro of that 100, 1% of that, and you put that into a Save My World bucket, and don't give me these asset class allocation stuff. Just put it into Save My World, and that money goes into making the climate better, gender equality, ESG reporting, funding things like Amarjeet is setting up with SEBI, the social stock exchange. So that money flows there out of us that lies today with the pensions and the sovereign funds and the 100 wealthiest families. $200 trillion lies with them. 1% of that, actually it's 267 trillion to be precise. 1% of that is $2.7 trillion that can flow towards India, Indonesia, Bangladesh, Cambodia, Africa, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, that would be, if that could happen, that would be revolutionary. So what will it take, Eloy, for the pension allocators to say, you know what, out of every $100 that I manage of pension capital, $1 is going for investments, not for charity, for investments, for, like you said, maybe a slightly lower rate of return, but it's going there to the NGOs, going to the social sector, going for climate change, going for innovation, et cetera, et cetera. What will it take? Is it rules, regulations?
So that's a very, very good question. So in the Netherlands, we're actually implementing pension fund reforms, which will lead to a situation where individuals have a larger degree of choice. So that system might lead to the possibility where trustees don't have to decide in a paternalistic manner this for all members. So millions, about 6 million people have a pension plan in the Netherlands. So in that case, the government will start reporting back to you how much money is invested on your behalf. And there are some discussions in Parliament now here that we will give people an extra degree of freedom to actually make these type of choices. It's very difficult under the current law for trustees within their fiduciary duty to so-called allocate part of the money towards part of the investments would really save the world without any financial return. So I think this is probably one of the conundrums that we're in. I think that Mark Carney says it very well in his book, where he talks about building a better world for all, that currently, if you look at the area where good financial return actually goes together with really good impact in terms of environmental, social, and other issues, maybe it's only 5% of the current investment universe. And that so-called divine intersection of good returns and building a better world has to grow from 5 to 9, so let's say to 95%. We have to reverse that. And that may mean lower financial returns, but a situation where we would actually tax part of that money away, that would be a role for the government, right? So I do think that governments have to take greater risks. So one of the problems of the commitments out of the Paris Climate Accord, where $100 billion was reserved for actually helping energy transition in emerging markets, that money has not been disbursed. That undermines trust and confidence in the court. And so governments also have to take more risk, and particularly in the advanced economies, they should use part of the tax dollars to take more risk, right, to build these public-private partnerships so that pension funds can actually start investing in a more responsible way. And new partnerships, and it's one of the SDGs, building partnerships. I'm very enthusiastic about the initiative now in Africa for building a African green infrastructure investment bank, which has a clear green mandate, because the sovereign wealth and pension funds of Africa have indicated that they were willing to allocate 5% of their investments towards these type of infrastructure opportunities. And it would be an ideal platform to team together with multilateral development banks, with long-term investors from abroad, to actually invest in energy transition. And so in private markets, there are also huge opportunities now for new collaborative efforts. And I'm convinced they can be both green and profitable, but we need to structure them in a different way than we have in the past.
Yeah, they do go hand in hand. Profits and green do can go hand in hand. Amarjeet, last question to you on this topic is, you know, we had the CSR from the government, which forced companies to give away 2% of profits. The financial intermediaries, whether they're insurance companies or you know, banks don't come under your purview, nor do insurance companies, but what does come under SEBI's purview are mutual funds, the brokers, etc. Is there any, and you know, this I say from someone with Helper NGO who's got this systematic giving plan, which Winnie has been crying horse about for 3 years to Amfi, etc. Not a single mutual fund house besides Quantum has adopted it. Does it require SEBI intervention, like there was from the ministry, to force such action? Because voluntarily, you know, it's not really happening. There's no desire to, you know, create the funnels or the plumbing or the pipelines to you know, help in terms of SDG goals, 17 attainments, you know, at least from what we've seen in our experience dealing with Amfi, etc. Any thoughts on that? I don't mean to put you on the spot, but I will partially put you on the spot.
No, Adit, you know my views on this. So you know, first of all, I just love this product. It's a great product that you have and another mutual fund has. And I love it for its simplicity. And let me maybe start with a disclaimer. These are my personal views, you know. So you know, the what I like about this is its simplicity. As an investor, I can simply, you know, authorize the fund to take part of my returns and give it to a good cause, which I like. So I am personally a little surprised, if you ask me, as to why mutual funds have not picked it up. I was a little more surprised, especially, you know, in the last 2 years were difficult years in many ways for many people, COVID time. And I thought this kind of, and people wanted to donate. So this kind of product would have really helped in raising resources for the needy people. But let me, you know, from the SEBI side, my understanding is there is no regulatory intervention in the sense required, because already two schemes are operating without any regulations as such. But I do believe that perhaps some nudge would be helpful, either by way of an advisory or whichever form it may take, since industry is not moving on its own. And by the way, this also, you know, is part of the recommendations of the Committee on Social Stock Exchange, because this is one important piece there.
Correct. So thank you for that. Well, last question to each of you. Eloy, I'll start with you. A young person getting into college, graduating from college, someone who's got their first job, trying to figure out what they should do next in life, what do they need to do to equip themselves for the next 20 years to be future ready for this intervention and this interaction between capital, finance, money returns, SDG 17, climate change? What should those individuals be doing?
Well, that's an absolute excellent question, Ajit. And I think that the young people will look very closely and should look very closely on those developments that will shape this world to be a better place in the future. So those companies that can really make a difference. So that will be the sectors that you would like to work for. And those are the sectors where you want to maybe do your university studies. So for instance, in the Netherlands now in Amsterdam, there's this new study in Amsterdam called Future Planet Studies. It's wonderful. I wish we would have had it in my time. You know, it's, and I think very importantly, we have to change the way we teach economics. So that's one of the things I'm really looking very closely to, what my son is getting taught now at the University of Utrecht as he starts his economic studies, that unfortunately still, we tend to think in economics in terms of old models, and all, you know, efficient markets and that we've moved to that the market economics and market societies are somehow the panacea for the future of this world. And I think that the young people realize very well that this is not necessarily the case, that we have to use the new models, and that companies need to actually show their responsibility towards realizing more than only a financial return for the shareholders. And if they don't, they will lose their license to operate. And the young people, because they can vote with their feet, they can change their consumption patterns, they will have a huge impact. But of course, it requires them to change their consumption patterns, to want to work for different places. And it's an example, for instance, Royal Dutch Shell in the Netherlands has difficulty attracting talent nowadays, because young people don't want to work for the company. Yeah. They still don't have made clear, you know, what their new credible strategy is to actually support, climate change mitigation. And that's true for a lot of industries still. But we're seeing the changes of that happening, because young people are actually voting with their feet and voting with their consumption patterns. So the fact that we get new regulations, for instance, in Europe, the SRB2 regulation, where retail investors have to be facilitated now that they can cast their vote in the AGM, is also hugely important. So one of my dreams is that we move to a situation where if you have your app and you invest in a company, that by your broker, that you're not only triggered in, you know, that you get the lowest transaction price and facility of, you know, when you take out your dog,
you get the carbon footprint while you're walking. Yeah.
But ideally, while you're walking, you should also be able to cast your vote on the social policies, the income disparities between management and the workers, diversity and inclusion, environmental policies of these companies. So I think that's all crucial. And for us, that seems maybe still difficult to imagine, but I think really, truly, within a decade or so, that will be increasingly normal. And companies have to completely change their way to communicate with investors. Now they think about investor communications mainly through analysts and talking directly to institutional investors. I think the future is they have to talk with all of their stakeholders, including their retail investors. It's a completely different ballgame. But the regulators, by putting out these requirements for companies to report other things than financial metrics, will be hugely beneficial in terms of changing this whole mindset and culture and practice. So in Europe, the Green Deal and all the reporting requirements that come together with it will really be a game changer. And I think India is being a game changer at this point. So a lot of these things will come together, and I think we won't recognize the way we look at companies in about 5 to 10 years from now. It's going to be very different.
May your sweet words come true. Amarjeet, as the game changer within SEBI, as SEBI being the game changer in the world, what do you think young people should be doing? How should they be equipping themselves for this and to be future ready?
So that's a great question, Ajit. So, you know, what my take on this is, if somebody who wants to be an entrepreneur today, so you have various forms of capital. So it would be financial capital, human capital, social capital, physical infrastructure. But the most important to my mind today is the intellectual capital. So I think the intellectual capital is becoming a huge creator of value, and it is replacing financial capital and other forms of capital. So I think one should invest more into that. And if you have intellectual capital, financial capital will follow. You know, you have a lot of funders today, private equity players who are there to support you if you have a great idea. So I think my advice would be invest in ideation skills, innovation, innovative thinking and approach. I think that's what I think, number one. Second is, you know, if you look at all those future of jobs studies, many studies now which have come out, very clearly the indication is that all the routine jobs, will be done by machines. So what would be left for humans would be more in terms of decision-making skills. You know, the thinking ability. So I think those are some core things which are very important, plus an appreciation of the technology around you. See, each company is today investing in cloud computing, data analytics, algorithmic solutions, and machine learning. So unless one understands this ecosystem, one would not be able to find one's place in the corporate world. So I think these are some important dimensions to my mind, which are important.
Thank you very much. Eloy, Amarjeet, absolute joy as we move towards a world of numbers, to a world of planet, people, and profit. Subbu, my colleague, will ask you questions for about 10 minutes, and then Winnie will take over to close the session. I hope I can make you all stay for a little longer. It's been a very engaging conversation. Thank you very much to both of you.
Thank you, Ajit. Thank you, Eloy. Thank you, Amarjeet. While Ajit was speaking and Eloy was answering, Amarjeet, I saw your hand raise. Was there a question you had in your mind?
No, I just wanted to supplement on the BRSR. So I forgot to mention an important point. It was that, you know, if a company is actually disclosing as per any reputed international standard, like let's say GRI framework or SASB framework and so on, then it doesn't have to do it all over again for BRSR. So we provided an interoperability of the frameworks, just keeping the ease of doing business in mind. So if disclosure is being made as per a recognized framework, some cross-referencing can be done and that should be fine.
Amarjeet, the first question, from what I can read in the chat, is you clarified on the social stock exchange, but can you elaborate it a little more from a retail investor point of view? How can they participate in this exchange? You gave some reference to large companies participating, but maybe if you can just tell us what can a retail investor do that will help.
So, you know, retail investor, first of all, he has to make up his mind whether he's coming. So there are two roads. One is the non-profit road, whether he's coming for financial returns or he's coming for social returns. And both are possible on this exchange. So if you are coming for financial returns, you need to invest in a for-profit entity, which is going to create impact, which will be basically an impact investor. And it will also give you financial returns. But financial returns may be not as high as one would probably expect in a normal, you know, kind of investment. So that is one route. Second is, you know, I don't really expect any financial return. I am there to donate my money, but this donation comes with an expectation. I don't want my money to go down the drain. I want to see the social returns which are generated out of this donation. So the nonprofit entity where this donation will go, that nonprofit entity is mandated to make disclosures on the exchange in terms of, and there's a disclosure matrix around it. And those disclosures will also have the assurance of a social auditor. So that's the path for the retail investor.
Thank you. I think that was useful. Eloy, from your side, the question which has come on the chat is, in India is still a very, the pension penetration in India is still very low. So if you were to advise India how to move towards a more pension-oriented society, based on your experience in your country, what kind of advice you will give? How do we develop the pension system a lot more robustly in India?
Yeah, so that's a very good question. I think that building pension funds is crucial to also developing local capital markets. The good thing is that they can be the ideal partners for long-term investors, aligned long-term investors to co-invest locally. And so actually peer-to-peer learning is also an important factor in building platforms between these long-term investors. So while a long-term investor will be less likely maybe to set up a technical learning arrangement with a commercial counterparty, maybe it will be more willing to do so peer-to-peer with another long-term investor. So I think from multiple perspectives, developing the deepness of local capital markets, getting the expertise in place to do direct investments in the own economy, building these peer-to-peer international platforms, I think that there's huge potential in India to do these type of things. I think this is one of the things I think that makes me also very hopeful about scaling up green investments in Africa, that there are a lot of local long-term pension plans in countries like South Africa, Kenya, Ghana, that actually can be used as a base for building platforms for this peer-to-peer learning and peer-to-peer investing. So I really hope those are going to be the future collaborative models that we can work with.
And you see that those collaborative models develop the pension market in countries like India. It can.
Yes, definitely, because I think that the regulatory environment in India is a very stable one. And don't forget, of course, that with fiscal dominance in Europe and the US for a long time to come, real returns on government bonds will be negative here. So pension funds need to, we have huge allocations in the Netherlands and Europe for insurance companies. You know, 40% at least or more is actually invested in very low to negative yielding assets as a kind of protective measure, almost as an regulatory driven, but regulation is changing. That is going to give them more freedom to move to other asset classes. For instance, sustainable real estate, I think, can be seen as sustainable infrastructure as a future substitute for what in the past used to be a government bond, and gives you a nice inflation-linked return. And I think these type of platforms that allow these investments will become more and more direct. So very large pension funds will probably start setting up their own real estate developers that invest on their behalf, cutting out the middlemen. So you can do it almost as a, so all of the returns generated flow back to the members, but then you can also do special things, like building care facilities for the elderly, building real estate for the very long term, because you don't intend to sell the real estate. You don't intend to flip the real estate. You intend to keep it in your portfolio and harvest the returns to pay pensions in the future. So then you have an interest in building very good buildings with a very low energy consumption. Nowadays we're thinking of building big buildings which are net negatives in terms of taking carbon out of the air, the way they operate. So there's all these wonderful opportunities, but they do require this very long-term focus and collaboration and I think peer-to-peer learning.
Thank you. So one last question to you, Eloy, again, is over the next decade, if you have to look between India versus China, how do you look at these markets? What kind of opportunities do you see between the two markets or in both the markets? Or do you see now China having grown in size? Are there more opportunities in India?
So I think over the past 20 years, China has been, of course, a huge beneficiary from capital flows from long-term investors in all kinds of categories, from public to private. And that will continue to be the case, as China, I think, is an important factor in diversifying global portfolios. But I think the competitive advantage of India, with its current focus on sustainable development and the quantum leap improvements that can be achieved, actually make probably on balance in the next couple of years, India a somewhat more attractive destination for capital for people that are diversifying. So the European investors are already quite diversified, but on a relative basis of their emerging markets exposure, I think more can go to India. I think the Americans are still so domestically focused that on balance, it will bring more capital out. And India obviously will also be a beneficiary. But I think this type of reporting, the focus on sustainable development, and the good returns that can be achieved in Indian markets all argue for good allocations to India. I'm sure that China will also be doing its best to attract capital. That's the way it should be. I think let the countries that maintain the most sustainable practices hopefully be the best beneficiaries of beneficiaries of these capital streams, these long-term capital streams.
Thank you, Elon. Do we have time or?
Yes, Subbu, I think we can take one last question.
Okay, so just let me go back to Amarjit, there have been some questions about recent investor complaints about companies like Karvi. Would you want to take that over here? Because it's come on the chat. What is SEBI doing? Or
I would rather give it to us.
Okay. That's fine. Well, my job was to ask the questions which come on the chat. But I think by and large, we have covered all the questions, unless Ajit has some other questions which you want to ask.
Well, yeah, maybe just one question to Amarjit, last one, is that within SEBI, is there like a very broad movement to implement these? Obviously, the momentum has started. And how much more is SEBI looking around the world saying, okay, this is what's been done in Europe. Like as Eloy mentioned, they've got the brandings of the funds. So in India, we've got the riskometer. And over there, they've got the sort of ISO fund green or red or orange or what is it? So in some sense, will SEBI eventually be moving towards that? That each time there's an IPO, each time there's a fund, you have to disclose in some riskometer level where you stand on the ESG metrics?
So let me put it this way. So there are 2-3 pieces to it, in the context of our engagement on the ESG issues. So we have dealt with the disclosure piece first. Again, I'm not saying that is cast in stone. I'm sure that will also continue to evolve as we move along. The second piece is, on the scorecard or rating or some sort of a riskometer, investors would, like to have one single indicator for easier understanding as to where the company stands when it comes to ESG issues. And another piece as a regulator where we come in is that are these schemes true to their label? So, is there any greenwashing happening? Is there any mis-selling of the schemes happening in the name of ESG? So these issues are now gaining our attention. And mind you, there are not any, international benchmarks available around these issues. ISCO is still working on developing principles around this. But we are very much seized of this because, in the last couple of years, just last less than 2 years, we've seen 8 or 9 ESG schemes have been launched in the mutual fund space. So we are keeping a close watch and we will deal with these issues, going forward. So they're very much on our radar, I would say.
Great. Thank you again, everyone. Winnie, the next 3 minutes of the future and beyond belongs to you in your stable, able hands. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Ajit. And thank you, Amarjit and Eloy, for your insights into how we can future ready our portfolios and ourselves. Now, interestingly, SDGs and the Indian CSR law were actually formulated and implemented around the same time. In fact, in 2014, India became the first country to mandate CSR, which is a praiseworthy move since 92,000 crore rupees have been disbursed to NGOs so far via CSR. Also, the approval of the SSE by the SEBI board today will be a welcome move since, it will offer more funding structures as listed out by you, Amarjit, for Indian social enterprises and NGOs. Now, this clubbed with the growing importance of ESG principles, the mandatory BRSR reporting for the top 1,000 listed companies, mapping the framework with the SDGs and the new comply or pay penalty rule for CSR will collectively provide the much needed boost to the social sector in the years to come. And maybe going ahead with Ajit's idea of having a Save My World fund will also help. Now for India to actually achieve the SDGs by 2030, there is a need for a more collaborative approach between the government, private sector, civil society, and most importantly, the citizens. For over two decades, Help Your NGO has been striving to increase transparency in the social sector and to offer easy solutions to support vetted NGOs. We are proud to present to you our latest initiative to encourage individuals to support NGOs working towards the 17 UN SDGs, which is this Hingo band. We've also launched our Did You Hingo social media challenge last evening with renowned entrepreneur Ronnie Screwala. Please allow me to share my screen to explain how you can support Hingo. Now, to support our effort, all you have to do is head over to the link shared in the chat box by my colleague and purchase the Hingo band, which will be packaged in a multi-purpose khadi pouch for just 200 rupees. By purchasing the Hingo band, you will be actually contributing to the corpus we are building to support credible and vetted NGOs working towards the UN SDGs. You will receive 50% tax deduction for your contribution and also program reports for complete transparency, so you can actually review how your donations are being utilized by the supported NGOs. Now, let's move on to how you can participate in our challenge. It's extremely simple. Click a photo of you wearing the band, post it on social media with the hashtag DidYouHingo, and tag three or more friends to take on the challenge. So for us to be future ready, we need to Hingo. So the question really is, did you Hingo today? Because I did. With this, we conclude Help Your NGO's first two-day mega webinar series. I'm certain this was just the first of many. Thank you once again, Eloy and Amarjeet, for sparing time to speak with us. Thank you, Ajit, for moderating the sessions, and Subbu for all of the Q&A rounds. Thank you to all of the audiences. I hope you all enjoyed the discussions as much as I did. And special thanks to Quantum for assisting us in hosting this webinar. It was an absolute pleasure being with all of you today. Thanks, everyone, and have a great evening.
Likewise.
Thank you.
Have a great
day. Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.